Evil Squid Comics Podcast, Episode 8, Season 2.
8?
Yeah,
Seems like we've been doing more than 8.
I counted, we had like, I think we did like 62 or some before. So I think we're at like total like episode 70 or something.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Since we've restarted.
But only 8 this year, right?
Yes, this is our 8th one this year. So we missed a couple.
Maybe. We have missed a couple.
Not too bad.
Not too bad. If it's every other week, we did 8. I mean, it's only beginning of May. We maybe missed one. Yeah.
We're only in the 5th month, so.
That's true.
Probably not bad.
Not too bad.
We're more on time than Savage Dragon.
Hey.
You're more on time than probably every comic right now, aren't you?
Well, that's true, but.
Those will never happen.
I won't blame that.
Comics are over.
Comics are over. May 20th, dude. May 20th.
It's gone, huh?
All right, I'm Drew.
I'm Don.
I'm Scott.
And we get together every couple weeks and we talk about comic books. The shelter-in-place order is over, so we're here in person.
There you go.
So
Don's got his mask on. Or wait, no, I guess that's a beard.
That's a beard.
No more buffets ever again.
What?
That's so true.
No more comic books, no more movies.
Wow, I can't
want more having to go into an office.
I really want movie theaters to open up.
Yeah, no more movies.
No more movies.
I miss movie theaters.
True. I do too.
Can't even have a drive-in open.
I think they're maybe they're getting closer. I think they're getting closer on that.
I don't know. That would be the place to go.
The drive-in.
Well, I think the next is on the 18th. Can't movie theaters open? I think they can.
But I don't think they are.
I don't think they are
because they got nothing to show.
Well, that's probably true. Scared. Although Disney, I think, is still predicting that they want to release Mulan in like July or something.
Yeah, I think July. So, but straight I don't think they're not going to release it until more theaters can open. I think it's a problem. So even though our theaters can open, if the theaters in like New York and LA can't open, then it doesn't help.
Doesn't help. Them,
yeah. We need them all to open.
They can't make $50 million just with Wichita.
Can't just theaters. Make. Can't do it. No. Nope.
I don't know. It'd be a good tourist attraction, right? We get all those. COVID
Dude, that place would be. That place would be packed.
Well, this is what I find amazing is that the restaurants opened up, you know, in some areas. Yeah. But yet I see on Nightline or something, you know, oh, here's a restaurant in Colorado. The damn thing's packed. Everybody, you know, standing room only. I'm like, you guys have been that desperate for dine-in in some of these places? Holy cow.
Some people don't know how to cook, Scott.
Obviously.
Some people
don't. Well, my son was telling me that the Chipotle is here in Wichita, since that's where he works, but that they were like the number one in revenue nationwide. That people were flocking to
Chipotle
here in Wichita because of options being, you limited. Know, more limited and things. He's like, yeah, we're fucking crazy right now. You know, he was always coming home way late, you know, and everything. And now that everything, a lot of stuff's opened back up, he's like, oh, yeah, coming home on time. He's like, yeah, it wasn't too bad a little last year. But, yeah, during that, you know, 4 or 6 weeks of lockdown, oh, my God, that poor boy looked miserable all the time coming home. But
crazy out there.
Yeah.
It's a crazy world.
It's crazy out there.
Man, I didn't see any movies, I don't think. We talked about Extraction last podcast. Did you guys watch anything since then?
I've just been watching Ozark and The Last Dance.
I haven't been watching The Last Dance. I watched half of the first episode.
ESPN, I need ESPN. Don't have it.
It'll be on Netflix sometime.
Here you go. I got a couple things watching-wise. Clone Wars, Season 7. It finished off. Yeah. So watch
that. I finished Clone Wars, too. We finished all the Clone Wars.
Yeah, very good.
I'm on Episode 3 of Season 1.
Of Clone Wars? Mm-hmm. You got a ways to go?
You got a little ways to go. But Season 7 is really pretty good. I liked how it all kind of wrapped up.
That was cool how they made it concurrent with Revenge of the Sith. Yes, that was neat... It's a neat twist.
Yes, it was. But very action-packed. That freaking duel between Ahsoka and Maul was one of the best.
I still say the one in the Season 5 is better.
Okay.
But so, what happened? Zach and I were watching. Do you remember what happened to Savage?
Oh, I don't know. No.
Darth Maul's buddy?
Yeah, I don't know for sure.
Because he just disappeared.
Does he? Okay.
Well, I don't know, I missed it.
My memory is I must have missed it. Because that Season 5 is one of the better seasons, but I did not watch that entire season. So
gotcha.
I watched episodes throughout here and there. So I was thinking that he may have died somewhere in one of them that I missed.
He may have, and I just forgot. So, I mean, there's a lot of information in this episode.
That could be. But, so yes, I don't know for sure. But because I watched Season 7 and finished that off, I started on Rebels, because that's kind of like the next one there. And so I'm about halfway through Season 1 on that.
Yeah, we decided to watch some movies instead.
How many seasons of Rebels are there?
There's not too bad there. It's only four.
Jesus.
Yeah. And one of the seasons...
They're not that long. One of the seasons... Two of them are shorter.
Like 12 of them are 14. Like...
but two are like 22 or 24.
Yeah, or something like that. Yeah.
Are the Clone Wars all like 30 episodes or something?
No, 22 is most of them, but then seasons 6 and 7 are only like 12 or 13.
Yeah. Still a lot of time there, though. But they're only half hour type things, you know?
Yeah, they're like 22 minutes.
I know.
So it's not too bad, but yeah, it takes some time. Commitment.
I don't know. Zach and I made it through. We watched like a couple of a night. Type
things, yeah. Problems. The other thing, though, Disney Gallery on Disney Plus. Have you watched that at all?
Disney Gallery?
Yes, it's like their thing that they're trying to produce here, new thing, but it's like behind the scenes of popular Disney stuff.
Yeah, in this case, I heard about it.
They've got Mandalorian.
Yeah, I heard they did a Mandalorian.
And they're going to do like 8 episodes or whatever. The first one was really good. You need to spend the time to watch it. The second one, it's so-so. They could have really done everything they needed to do in one episode, to tell you the truth. But it's like a round table of the directors and Jon Favreau, you know, who's producing in that first one. It is great. Dave Filoni or whatever. Mm-hmm. His story about getting the... I'm going to spoil that for this part just because it cracks me up. But his story about how he gets the interview with Lucasfilm to do Clone Wars is hilarious. I mean, he's basically talking about that he was working on Avatar, The Last Airbender on Nickelodeon. And he gets the phone call from Lucasfilm. And they call him up and saying that it's Lucasfilm Animation. And they want to speak with him. And he's like, okay, I know a lot about Star Wars because I'm a Star Wars geek, and I know there was not a Lucasfilm Animation. So he's like, I'm like, yeah, this is somebody yanking my chain. He goes, the SpongeBob guys were giving me crap all the time. He goes, I was just sure this was them that set me up, you know, type things. And so he's like on here, he's like, yeah, yeah. And they're like, yeah, we'd really like to meet with you, you know, this type of stuff. He goes, yeah, I'd like to meet with you too, you know, this type of thing. Just being... you know, kind of sarcastic and almost a little general ass, you know, or whatever. And they schedule an interview and everything. And he's like, yeah, so who put you up to this? And they're like, I don't know what you're talking about. And they're like, yeah, come on. Who was it? Was it the SpongeBob guys? She's like, this is Dave Filoni, right? From Nickelodeon, does The Last Airbender. And he's like, yeah, it is. Well, yeah, this is, we're really setting this up. He goes, oh, and then he's like, I just got it. He's like, oh my God, this is really them. They're like, then. We do have the right guy, right? And he's like, oh, I am the right guy. I'm so the right guy. I have a Jedi robe in my garage right now, you know, or something. And then he's like, yeah, I was like starting to take this phone interview right down. He's like, I think she would have like totally cut me off right there if we hadn't already set up an interview. And then he says that he goes, you know, for the interview and meets Lucas. And he thinks he has no shot at all. You know, he goes in there, tells him, you know, shows him some of his stuff. And then George, you know, sits here and just starts talking to him, you know, almost like a just conversation about Jedis and things of this nature. And he's like, oh, my God, it was just so cool. George Lucas was everything I thought he would be, you know, very personable, all this type stuff, you know, had all this great knowledge of things. He goes, it was like the best day of my life, you know, type things. I was like, oh, man, this is going to get my nerd credit way the hell up there. You know, when I'm waiting in line for Revenge of the Sith, I can tell all these guys, I met George Lucas, you know, things. And so he's like, yeah, I thought this is great. And he goes, yeah, then they send me back to sit in the green room. And he's just like, yeah, oh, man, this is just great. I got a great experience, whatever else. And then they knock on the door and they're like, yeah, George likes you. You got the job. We'll give it back to you for the rest of the paperwork and stuff. And then just close the door and whatever. He's just like, just shell shocked, but so it was pretty good. But there's a lot of stuff like that throughout that first episode, which is pretty good. On each one of the directors, you know, talking a little bit about their backgrounds and things, and what they were bringing to it, you know, and stuff. So the first episode, I definitely would say check it out.
Cool. You see, Robert Rodriguez is going to direct one of the season 2 episodes of The Mandalorian.
No, but did you see Boba Fett's coming back?
Yes, I did.
Yes, played by, what's his name?
The guy who played
Jango Fett.
Oh, Jango Fett. Yeah.
Yes, yeah.
Correct.
They should have got the kid grown up to play.
Yeah, that's probably true, too.
No, I'm just kidding. He probably looks nothing like... He
probably looks nothing like a clone.
Name. It's so funny. There's this kind of guy who's kind of obnoxious, but he's a big Star Wars fan, who's always like in a cube, like... next to mine. He's not in the same cube as me. There's like 2 walls between us. But he talks like to everybody in the office can hear or whatever. And he's complaining about stormtroopers and how, like, you know, they're like, we're supposed to be clones and blah, blah, blah. And how, like, They never explained how, like, Finn was a stormtrooper or whatever, because they're supposed to be clones, blah, 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 blah. So I went to Wikipedia and said, yeah, and I took, like, an excerpt and, like, yeah, emailed it to him. Because I guess after the Clone Wars, the Emperor actually started using conscripts or whatever for stormtroopers, not clones anymore. Like, right. He stopped doing
clones.
Well,
they had the whole Imperial Academy. But they never really
explained that very well in the initial original trilogy or whatever.
That's true, yes.
Or I don't think they ever explained it in the prequel trilogy, because they didn't even get that far.
Well, the prequel didn't get to that point.
Correct, that's what I'm saying. Even in the middle trilogy,
the most you hear about is an Imperial Academy. Correct. You know, type thing. So you know that there's some type of training of young teenagers or whatever going on.
Anyway, so I had to use my Wikipedia searching and send that to him.
There you go.
Because everything on Wikipedia is true.
Well, I mean, it's still knowledge.
I did watch Rise of Skywalker again.
See, here's how you know it wasn't a very good movie, is that it's on Disney Plus, I can watch it for free, and I still don't watch it. That's a bad sign.
Here's the thing, though.
The third time?
The third time through. I watched it again mainly because Xander hadn't watched it. So, and we were having a conversation about Star Wars or something, and then I realized he hadn't seen Rise of Skywalker. I was like, oh my God, come on, now it's free. Here, we'll watch it on Disney Plus. So I drug his ass to watch it. And to his credit, he watched the whole thing, and he said, yeah, it's not too bad. He expected it to be even worse of a train wreck. But, and then as I'm sitting there watching it, I'm like, you know, grudgingly, it's not as bad as what my initial just gut feeling was. I mean, it's still...
It's just mediocre is the problem.
That is the problem. And I think that's the conversation we had. I was like, when I was young, and part of this is that, you know, rose-colored glasses that I had when I was 12, when I watched Return of the Jedi wrapped everything up so nice. You know, you had action. Everything was set up in the previous two films. You know, you knew there was the big bad of the Emperor from Empire and everything else, this type of stuff. While you hadn't really seen him, you knew he existed. So there wasn't like this initial setup that needed to be there or something. You know, it was just action, some little things here and there. But it wrapped everything up to, you know, a happy fairy tale ending, you know, or whatever the hell else. But you felt like you got earned throughout the three films. Or at least I did from, you know, at early age. You know, now watching this trilogy, it's just a hodgepodge, you know, because they didn't have the vision, I think, of where they wanted all three films to go. So the third film still spends so much time, you know, saying, oh shit, we need to set up a couple little things here so when we get to our little finale, it makes sense, you know, a little bit more. And it just seems like there's so much time wasted, I think, from what happened. And, you know, they should have not that Last Jedi was a bad film, even though I know you don't like it. But it has no reason being in this trilogy, you know, in some respects. They should have jettisoned that and had different people and whatever the hell else, made it a different movie, you know, type thing, filler movie, and made some other trilogy for this so that they could have really spent the time they needed in this last one to really, you know, take it home. That's the problem. You know, you hit the nail on the head. For something that was Star Wars, that is such a big, you know, industry, you know, intellectual property, to end on this big, you know, 9-part series of films on that movie, just is like, yeah, it's not even, you know, that it's okay, you know, type things. And not bad acting, you know, but they really just felt like you were just had to throw in a bunch of crap that you really, I don't know if you needed to.
Well, so. As you were talking, I was thinking about it. I mean, it really is a mediocre movie because the whole thing is mediocre, right? Like, there's no, like, standout, I don't think, moments or times in that movie that really blew me away. Even the Star Wars movies that people say were bad, like Phantom Menace, it still has some amazing sequences.
Yeah.
And like the lightsaber battle and the Duel of the Fates, the music, the sound, all that is just one of the greatest sequences in Star Wars. So, and the pod race is another one. It's just amazing. Like those two sequences elevate that whole movie, right?
Yeah.
Or like even Last Jedi. Last Jedi has some awesome sequences.
Oh, yeah.
Even if you hate the movie, it's like there's some awesome moments in that movie that you can't get around, you can't deny. that blew you away. Same with Force Awakens, I would say.
But I didn't even say Attack of the Clones. You know, that beginning part with the chase, you know, and things through Coruscant is really good.
Well, the end is even awesome. The end is really good. Battle of Geonosis, and when Yoda, breaks Jedi's out his life. Out there, you see Yoda use his lightsaber for the first time. I mean, that's amazing.
I mean, that may be the worst film of the nine series.
Correct.
In,
or it has amazing segments. But Rise of the Skywalker, I don't feel, had anything that blew me away to that level. Like, nothing was... Nothing rose above mediocre. There were no moments in it that were that's amazing, that's awesome.
Because they couldn't spend any time with it.
That maybe, you know, whatever the reason is.
Because that's what we were talking about, is there's that part in Rise of Skywalker where they're having this desert chase scene, and, you know, they even talk about it in behind the scenes, oh yeah, we had to set this up and everything. It's like, wow, you guys really put a lot of work in it for something that on screen you maybe took 5 minutes, if that, with? Because you needed to just say, oh, here, we need to throw some action in because we need to get to the next plot point to show that Rey can heal things now, you know, or whatever the hell else, you know, type stuff.
They can fly now?
But see, that's right, exactly. Now, that was almost one of the better parts, but it is so short, you know. When you have a pod race scene that lasted, 15 minutes of the damn film, you know, and it sticks with you because it's just cool action and whatnot. And then you have this thing that tries to get in there, you know, but it's like, we got to keep moving. Okay.
And that's why I'll go back and watch any of those movies that are not that good. There's a sequence in there that I'll watch 1,000 times, right?
Yeah.
And I don't think Rise of Skywalker has anything in it that I was like, oh, I'd watch that 1,000 times.
You know? Yeah, probably so. I mean, I do admit that the part there in the middle where Rey and Kylo fight there on that.
I mean, that's a pretty cool part. Sequence.
That is if I take it all the way from the point that she gets in there, you know, finds the Wayfinder, sees evil self, you know, to the point of, you know, having that fight that they have. That sequence is really pretty good. I probably didn't even appreciate it as much at first because I was still annoyed on the fact of how the hell she found the damn thing with this stupid-ass knife that I don't know what the hell that was for. But
this is the way.
It is. It is. Yes. Very much. I have spoken. So,
fair enough.
But yeah, anyway, sorry, digress there.
Okay.
But, one more nerdy thing before we get into reviews.
Nerdy thing.
Ooh, here you go. Look at that.
What is that? It's a retro collection.
Ooh.
Leia, why do you have these?
Whoa. Because I'm a nerd.
Why not that? Are these new?
They are new. It's, you know, the nice thing of Hasbro, is like nice cash grab from Hasbro. Those are like the original
tooling.
It's a classic tooling.
Wow.
You know, so they got the old look, you know, and things.
Have they not done this before?
They did it before for Star Wars, but because Empire, this is the 40th anniversary of Empire.
I love Luke and Tan.
I know.
I called them Luke and Tan.
Yes.
Luke and Tan.
With you. That was like one of my favorite Lukes right there.
Yes. The only problem was is that Luke and White, his lightsaber extended out, so when you had the lightsaber battles, it wouldn't fall off. Yeah. Him, it would fall out of his hand every time. Yeah. So I used tape, and I would try and wrap it around hold his lightsaber.
Did you put them
in the star case?
Yeah. Oh, you put them in the cases?
No, I put them in those. And then, of course, you had Han.
I never liked that
I wish they would have had the Bespin Han instead of the Han and Hoth, because that's my favorite. Han was the Bespin one, but
Bespin one's pretty good.
Yeah.
But yeah, I never liked the Han and Hoth.
Here you go. You gotta take a look at
Yoda.
At Yoda. But
Yoda was great.
It's nice and classic. His eyes are even almost.
I remember the snake being a different color though.
But there was two versions of that. They had the bright orange and they had the brown.
I think I had the brown.
That's how I bought it. I found them at Walmart. They're like a Walmart exclusive.
How much are they? $20 a piece?
Oh, gosh, no. Half that. So they're still kind of pricey for something, but it's $10. And they've got like the worn look around the edges, you know, and things to try to make it look like, ooh, wow, you know, type things. It's scuffed up, you know, and things like this, you know. So
you know what they should have done to really F with people?
Nope.
They should have put a little thing that you had to cut out to mail in
to
get an exclusive figure.
Yeah, get an exclusive.
It should be a Luke where his hand pops off.
Right.
That's what it should
be. And put a little chip in it.
You know, it's funny.
They could put a little chip in it and you push
his chest. He's Luke
and
tan. And I know in the picture it looks a little tan. Really, in the movie, it looks more like a dark gray or a dark brown, really. In some ways.
It
doesn't really look that tan.
Did I tell you the story we were watching Rise of Skywalker?
Yes, I think you told us that. Didn't you watch twice? In one
weekend? And Barbara's like,
I've never seen this.
How can Rey's costumes stay white, like her clothes stay white through this whole movie. It's like they never get dirty.
Yeah. But yes, Boba Fett, that was like one of my favorites too. We except for ours had a string around his neck.
I'm trying to figure out where Scott pulled these out of.
That, he brought that big case. That's why I brought the big case.
Gotcha.
Cool.
Just to kind of show off.
He pulled them right out of his ass.
My early birthday present. Yeah, and so then the other thing I brought was...
Oh, Everdale.
Everdale.
Are we going to play that?
Not right now.
Oh, darn.
But the main thing is that being a comic podcast, you know, the thing on this, you know, a lot of times what we talk about...
Let's show it. Everdale, the board game. It's a board game, people, for those who don't know what Everdale is.
Yeah, for those...
Was this a Kickstarter?
I know it was a Kickstarter, but I did not buy the Kickstarter version. But here's the thing. I mean, look at the art on this stuff. It is just...
It's no Raccoon Tycoon, but it's
pretty It's cool. not Raccoon no, Tycoon, but, you know, it is... It's really, really good and, you know, got that cutesy look for families and whatever the heck else. So.
Have you played this game?
I have not actually played the game. I've read the rules, watched some little videos on it. It's... I think you'd hate it personally. I don't know.
I don't hate any game.
I know, that is true. It's worker placement.
I like worker placement.
But
I just hate Lords of Waterdeep. Is that
okay? Yes, that's okay. It's worker placement with a touch of an engine builder type thing. Okay. You're building a city with like the little critters and their stores. But it's got like this whole... freaking tree that you build to put some stuff on there. So visually, it's, you know, it looks really, really nice.
I like Kalos.
So
I like Pillars of the Earth. Their worker placement.
Champions of Midgard.
I like Champions of Midgard. I like worker placement.
You do. I know. I just always have to give you crap because of the fact that you...
You think I don't like worker placement. I think you don't like worker placement. Just because I hate Lords of Waterdeep.
Because hated one game.
Because Lords of Waterdeep is stupid.
But yes, art by... It looks like Andrew Bosley. Never really heard of him, but it's really fantastic looking art. So, gives it a look that I think will at least entice the family to give it a shot, you know, type things.
I was just thinking when you broke out those action figures. So today, Silas, our grandson, came over, and he was grounded from his phone. So when he gets grounded from his phone, it's like he goes batshit because he's always playing on his phone. So. Kristen was over there. She's like, "Does he have any toys over here?" And Barbara's like, "Ah, there's like a little basket up there." Well, I had in the garage. I had.
Why is he grounded from his phone?
Huh?
Why is he grounded from his phone?
I don't know.
Something not good.
But anyway, so I had a plastic tub of like some of my G.I. Joe toys. Like
you still from
have G.I. Joe?
Yeah,
have some?
I still have some.
That's worth millions.
And so. I brought it out and we opened it up and we were looking at it. And there, I had an old, the Crystar figure in there.
Oh, nice.
And I had.
Does it have the bow?
It's the green one, but he doesn't have any, like, it's just the figure. It doesn't have any accessories. And then there was some G.I. Joe stuff, and then there was some Star Wars stuff mixed in there. And there was a Boba Fett figure and the Han in the Hoth.
Oh, wow. And rocket firing Boba Fett?
Yeah.
No. And I was like, I showed him the Han, and I was like, "Who's this?" And he's like, "Luke." And I'm like, "Nope."
And guess again.
Barbara was sitting on the oven. She's like, "The other one." And he goes, "Han Solo." She's like, "Yeah." But anyway, I just had those two figures in my hand.
Oh wow! Was that a good representation of them from the originals?
From what I remember, from what
you
got.
You don't have the originals.
I do a lot of them.
Oh, okay.
But I have been selling them off, you know, piece by piece here and there.
But it was funny because I have, like, several of the G.I. Joe action figure, and I had some of the vehicles. And he was sitting there playing with them, and he's like, "Is this a good guy or a bad guy?" And I'm like, "That's a bad guy." And he's like, "Is this vehicle for the good guy or the bad guy?" And I'm like, "It's the bad guy." And he's like, "Oh, he fits in it." He put him in there. I was just like,
woohoo! And there we go. Yeah.
Good anyway.
Times. Good times. But yes, I thought you'd get a kick out of seeing some retro look, you know, action figures. I know when I saw them, I was like, ah!
Yeah, there's probably people who would like to collect action figures. But
I know.
I just don't need more stuff.
No, right? I know. Well, you see my house, so well, yeah, I mean, no. That's all I have, though, is just those ones with the old look, you know, type
right.
stuff. And of course, the wife said, after it wraps around the house.
I'm jealous.
Not wraps around the house. After it wraps around that basement, I can't, any more that I get, I have to get rid of. So I'm almost to that point.
That's kind of where I'm at. I can't fit any more board games or books or anything.
Yes. So I do have to start doing the swappage more often. So I might have some like...
I don't know. I just can't get rid of books.
Board games to sell really cheap too. Who knows?
I'm like running out of room, but I just can't get rid of them.
Yeah, I understand. Do what you gotta do.
So other news, Marvel website or whatever the hell, weren't they like closing it? Or did you talk about that one or something?
No, I don't think it's a big deal. I think they're just closing their digital shop.
Okay.
For comics, but you can still buy them through the Marvel app and buy them through the Comixology app.
That's what I heard.
You just can't buy them through the webpage for some reason.
Huh.
I don't know what that's all about.
You can still get the Marvel Unlimited, though?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
They still got to make their money through that.
I still say they still have an app that you can buy stuff from through, I think. You just can't buy them through the website, I think. I think. I don't know. I just use Marvel Unlimited, so I don't really care. I know you can get them through Comixology, though.
Are you talking new comics?
Yeah.
Oh. Who cares?
Exactly.
Print, baby.
Print, baby. There is no print. Not coming back till May 20th.
May 20th is when everything.
When Diamond is shipping new books.
Diamond?
Now, what about DC?
DC's been shipping through these other two companies.
Yeah, they? So you could still get your DC stuff?
Who?
DC.
DC is shipping through all three. They have three distributors now.
That screws the other two.
So as a retailer, you can choose what distributor you would like to get through.
That pretty much screws the other two.
Maybe.
Oh, it kind of does. And they said that they had an interview with like the DCBS people, and they were like, yeah, we don't know what's going to happen once Diamond comes back online. We understood that this was just kind of a
placeholder.
A placeholder. DC approached us.
That seems like a lot of work for a placeholder.
Well, they were saying that they've been approached by people who can't get distributed through Diamond about distributing them. So it's like, well, now we have some infrastructure. Maybe we could do that. You know what I mean? Yeah. And it gives them contacts to like all these comic book stores that could potentially order some stuff through them if they had other stuff that Diamond didn't have. And gets their foot in the door. I don't know. DCBS was set up for a kind of distribution anyway. It's really not that much different than what they do.
Kind of, sort of, yeah.
I mean, they've just been getting books directly from DC instead of Diamond, and they're shipping it to stores instead of customers.
I read a few things after they sent out their first shipment, and people were complaining about the shipping. Yeah. The shipping was insanely expensive, apparently.
Because they don't get the big discount that Diamond does.
Right. And they said that they were going to work on that, and they were getting deals, and they were going to be able to cut down. But the other thing was, I guess, people were really impressed with the foam.
Yeah, well, they were saying that stuff was actually didn't get damaged. Because everything Diamond ships gets damaged. But DCBS actually knows how to ship stuff without damaging it. But that's probably why their shipping is a little more.
Because
the stuff probably weighs a little more, because there's actually, you know, inserts
some
and
packing
stuff
material
in.
Right,
and a little bit larger boxes usually when that happens.
Correct.
So, yeah,
in a lot of places I know, what is it, FedEx, you know, they go almost more off of box size than they do weight in almost anymore in some cases. So anyway
yeah, I heard that the shipping was bad, and
so Diamond is going to start shipping again on May 20th.
Yes. And all the publishers have like come
up. So you're
going
to get a
like,
ton of crap to start reading again.
No, because they're not flooding. Like, they're not giving you everything that was supposed to ship the last month and a half.
Oh, really?
They're going to slowly trickle it out. So stuff that was supposed to ship in like May is now that might not be here till late June or July.
Wow.
So everything's staggered.
Where's most of the printing done? Type things.
China.
Is it China? Okay, I thought that was probably a case because almost everything's done in China.
I think Eric Larson alluded that to one point because we were like,
oh, I'm sure it is.
Okay.
It's probably cheaper.
Yeah, I'm sure it is.
Okay. I just was curious, and yeah, that would make sense then, why things would get delayed there, you know, type stuff.
Doesn't it say inside a comic book where it was printed?
I have no idea.
I have no idea.
Does it say something like that?
I would think it.
It's in fine print that I can't read anymore, so my eyes aren't good.
Printed in Belfast.
I thought the DC ones were at the back.
I don't know, man.
Here it is.
I can't hold this bat far enough away from my face in order to read it.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Printed by Transcontinental Printing Interweb Montreal.
The
division
Wow.
Transcontinental Printing Inc., Boucherville, OCQC, Canada.
So those are printed in Canada.
A Warner Media, DC, a Warner Media company. It even has the date.
Amazing.
This one was printed in the USA.
Well, there you go.
Printed in the USA.
So
I would assume all DC goes through Canada, but that one's in the United States.
These are image books.
Right. Do you have any more? No, you don't.
So look at that.
Marvel.
So it's not held up for China, it looks
you
like.
Have Dark Horse, though.
Yeah. So, I don't know, man. It's a mystery.
Printed in Canada.
I guess Canada's a lot of the
I guess it's not
okay.
China like we thought.
Okay. Well, good.
Maybe the trades are printed in China.
Could be. Could be. I happen to have older trades.
Well, this makes sense. It's Usagi Yojimbo. It's printed in Korea.
Of course it is.
Of course.
But that's Japanese. You realize Korea and Japanese are not the same country.
I know.
Okay.
I do.
Just checking.
So maybe IDW does all their printing in Korea.
This one, way back in the day, Vertigo, printed in Canada.
Wow. Who knew Canada did so much printing?
Boom. They got all those trees.
Boom? Trees?
Yeah. No,
Canada. Yes.
They have a lot of trees.
That is good. Sense. Yes.
Hey, this one was printed in the USA.
Wow.
Boom.
Yes, it was.
Get my books a lot ordered.
Yeah. Oh, man. Now you can't read anything.
What about this one?
Can't preview anything, can you?
AWA Upshot. AWA. This was printed in Canada.
Hmm. All right. Okay, so we know that now.
All over the place.
All over
now, the every place. Comic I read.
Except
I'm
for China.
Where it's printed. Yes. Everything but China.
Well, why don't you guys do a review where I check every single book I have?
No, 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 no. Any other news? Going once. Come
How
on.
How did you not? You didn't collect that?
In single issues?
Yeah.
I did not.
Oh.
I bought some of the trades. This is printed in Canada.
I see that.
I think they...
Why are you messing with all my books?
I'm holding them up for you to put your thing back.
Oh my God.
Fables.
Why are you touching my stuff?
God, dude. Spoiler. I was trying to help you.
There we go.
Never again.
Good.
Did you buy all the deluxe editions of Sweet Tooth?
I have not.
Okay.
Well, about the first one. Because it's about to go out of print. So I had to buy it.
That's right.
It's about to go out of print. They'll print it again.
Now when, Don?
When? When the movie comes out.
When, Don?
That's going to
be
worth
like...
There's going
to be a TV show.
$400.
The first print.
You can flip it.
Sweet. I'll keep it. I like it.
I was... Okay, so one other real quick thing. I'm friends with Andy Parks on Facebook.
Aren't you special?
And he didn't have books for... He didn't have See You Dad for when the movie came out.
Well, like, he should have been smart and rebranded that bastard as Extraction.
well, that's...
Or See You Dad, you know. Yeah.
But that book's out of print.
Extraction, who knows what.
I'm like...
That's a dumb move.
Why don't you... Print
so does the value just go way up
the
there?
Can I
sell
my sell
yours on...
I think mine's signed,
on eBay?
Get big money for that thing.
There you go.
Well, get on eBay or Amazon and see.
Oh, speaking of eBay, guess what is like actually selling for money? A little bit. Not a lot, but like...
Disinfectant.
Black Badge.
Oh, really?
Are they making it into a TV show?
I don't know. Boom apparently has a first look deal with Netflix, so all the Boom series are like booming. Huh, see the point? But anyway, someone was saying like Black Badge was like going for money. I'm like, dude, I was like... debating. I didn't really like that series. I was like, either I'm gonna get rid of it or I'm gonna bind it, but I don't really want to pay to bind it because I didn't even like it that much.
Well, you better go list it on eBay.
I want to get rid of it anyway. I'm like, well, I might as well sell it on eBay and get a little bit of scratch.
Heck yeah.
I mean, but that was like a week ago. It's probably already bottomed out.
We're like an hour into this thing and we haven't even talked about comics.
Exactly. I keep trying to keep getting distracted, dude. I'll tell you.
Well, I didn't read much, so
it's
you start.
Yeah, I didn't read much either. So this
we'll start with The Resistance. This is the new book by AWA, which is the company started by Axel Alonso. When he got fired from Marvel, he went and he started his own comic book company and he recruited a bunch of cool people like J. Michael Straczynski and Mike Diodato Jr.
Holy crap.
And this is a 6-issue series. It's called Resistance. This is almost a little too close to home. The story is there's a huge...
Isn't Frank Martin a basketball coach?
He's a colorist.
No.
Anyway, there's a virus that sweeps through the U.S. or no, through the world and like wipes out a bunch of people. Like it's like all the governments are collapsing, society's falling apart, blah blah blah. Then all of a sudden something happens and everybody starts getting better. Like just like that. Well, it turns out when this virus hit, it turned like a certain percentage of the population, a very small percentage, but it like gave them superpowers. So one of the people with superpowers actually sacrificed herself to cure, like, the rest, to wipe out this virus and save the world or whatever. But nobody knows. It's like a secret. So now there's this whole, like, group of people who are immune to the virus but also got, like, superpowers. And that's all the issue. It's really just about the virus. Rising
Stars type of
it thing. Is. You know, it seems like Straczynski's been trying to tell, like, the same story in slightly different ways for, like, 30 years. Like, Rising Stars, and then he did... He's been trying to crack that, like, Watchmen superhero deconstruction thing. And it's like he can't quite get where he wants to be, so he just keeps taking stabs at it. Because, like, Supreme Power was kind of that way, right? It was, like, Squadron Supreme. But you read Supreme Power, right?
I did.
I mean, that was the same kind of thing. It was kind of a Watchmen kind of deconstruction, what the superheroes were in the real world, blah, blah, blah. Rising Stars was kind of that way. I mean, he keeps... hitting that same thing, but I really enjoy it when he does it.
Well, so. He's a good writer, though, in general.
He's a good writer, so yeah. I enjoy it. So it was good. I enjoyed it. The Mike Deodato art was pretty cool. I mean, I'm used to him doing a little more flashier stuff. This is mostly just, like, the world dealing with a virus for most of the issue. There wasn't a lot of dynamic, exciting things going on. But it's cool. We'll see where it goes.
Wow, that's
it looks stuff. Like you can... pretty much sell them for like maybe $10 a piece if you're lucky.
All 12 of them?
Yeah, 1 to 12 for like $100.
Yeah, if I get $100, that's out of 1 to 12.
Though. Yeah.
But it bad. Said sign number 1. So 1 through 12 with a sign number 1 for $99.99.
Yeah.
And then another 1 through 12.
Yours are all signed, aren't they?
Yes. And then another 1 to 12 set for $62.
Yeah, so even if I get $50 out of them,
and then you can get
that's more
like
than I paid for them.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5 to 6 for around $50 or $60. So
yeah, so I don't know. We'll see.
Yeah, man, if you could dump 1 through 12 for like $100,
not bad. I'd take it because I don't like it, and
right,
I don't know what to do with them.
I probably would too. I don't have the last issue though.
Oh, that's a problem.
Maybe number 12 is gonna be worth the money. But then you'll get a weird one where it's a number 1 for, like, $25. See, that's what I never get about, like,
eBay.
Yeah.
So
right here, a number 1 for $25, and then right below it, a 1 through 12 set for $23.95.
But
so
that one
they
is
paid...
Is one buy it now and one bidding, or they're both bidding?
Oh, no, these are sold.
Oh, okay.
But this was... Yeah. The set was sold... on $325, and the number 1 was sold on $54, so maybe that's a little bit.
Yeah, that's the problem.
But you always see that.
I know.
Like...
Well, it's all about timing, dude. It's like with any of those
it
things.
It is. Yep.
So that's what I'm saying. I think right now the iron is hot. I got
to
go ahead and sell them before
people go.
It's already
before too many
out.
People read it and realize, this is nice stuff. So, bro.
Yeah, and I don't know why they think it's going to be worth money just because it might become a Netflix series.
Because that's all this business is
and
now.
And everything else.
That's all.
But like, okay. October Faction became a Netflix show. It got canceled after one season. There's not, like, people clamoring for the first issue of that, so no. I don't know.
There might have been. I never heard about
Umbrella
it.
Umbrella Academy?
Might have been.
And I don't think anybody cares about Walking Dead anymore. The
I
issues.
Don't think they do either.
Besides number one.
Speaking of Kirkman, so Outcast is still going. It's getting really close
to
wrapping up. I think there's only, like, 4 issues left or something.
Oh, okay.
So I saved up a bunch. I read them all at once. It's cool. I mean, you can tell it's heading towards the end game. The one guy, Kyle, I think is his name.
Yep.
Him and, like, all his people are, like, all in, like, a camp, and they're kind of sequestered, and they've got, like, a wall around them. They don't let people in.
How many issues is this?
It's going to be 48, right.
Well, I mean, that you read here in this chunk.
Like, I don't know, 8?
Okay.
I think I've read
those. Like,
when
the last one I read, when I don't remember what issue it was, like, felt like at that point in time it was getting to a... You know, the cat was out of the bag.
Yeah.
It was setting up your good and evil. Now you went through 8 issues, and you're just saying, it's still getting towards the end game.
Well, there's like 4 issues left, so they're really geared up towards the final battle.
Okay.
But like, so they're all holed up in like a compound, and then like the bad guys are all kind of circling and trying to figure out how to come in, and they can't quite do it. I don't think they can do a frontal attack because Kyle and his people, they can like grab onto him and like expel the... spirit
the
out
blackness.
Of the people. Yeah, and so...
Or whatever, the darkness.
So, you know, they're gearing up for, like, a big final showdown is what they're doing.
I think I've read those. Or
you
at least some
have.
Of those, because it sounds familiar.
Yeah.
Have you...
Well, they've been in this compound
you've
for,
read
like...
pretty much almost everything?
I think.
Okay.
I got caught up a little while ago.
Oh, then you're probably caught up, because I don't think... I've been holding these for a while. Of
like 12 issues.
At least 12 issues.
12 yeah. years. God. Since the beginning.
Yeah, it's for a while.
Well, that was my biggest problem with Outcast was, thank God you gave it to me in this big chunk, because I don't know if I would have stuck with it, because it was... It's still good writing of Kirkman, but man, it was a slow burn.
It is a slow burn. I really like the Paul as a set of artwork, so that helps me, because I dig his style. It's kind of different, but yeah, it's a cool book. I mean, it's just, it's time for it to be over, I think. It probably could have been 30 issues and been just as good, maybe better.
Hmm.
But who knows?
Outcast. But then you can't get four oversized, nice hardcovers.
It's true. He's all about the hardcovers. All right, I guess issues. One of you guys better do one, because I just knocked out most of my style, my pile.
All right, okay, I'll talk about this one. So, all I read was this horror series, and I read them out of order because I've been reading the... No, I mean, I didn't read them out of order. I didn't sit down and read all Basketball of Heads, and I didn't sit down and read all Dollhouse Family.
I don't care that
order. Because the back has the... backstory that goes through it. So I've been reading it in order of that.
The backstory. Okay, that makes more sense. Sorry, I thought you were like missing issues and other things.
So I read 3, 4, and 5 of Basketful of Heads. So there should be one more.
Did you talk a little bit about this one?
I did.
Okay.
So there should probably eventually maybe be another final issue of that coming out, because there was supposed to be 6 issues, but who knows with the way comics
chapter 10 of Sea Dogs. So you.
The Sea Dog story is only like 2 pages in the back of every book.
Which I just ignored it in mine. Cause
yeah, I got to thinking like if they're going to collect, because each series is like 6 issues.
Yeah.
If they're going to collect them all in just trades,
got a lightsaber.
How are they going to collect Sea Dogs?
I don't know. Maybe it's a single issue only thing.
Maybe.
Perhaps.
Anyway. All right, so
maybe they're going to publish it as its own comic at the end.
You digging that?
24 pages.
Yeah, I'm enjoying almost all of these. This one's probably one of my favorites, just because it's written by Joe Hill, and I kind of like the concept. But yeah, I mean, so there was a breakout of prisoners, and this girl was at this house with her boyfriend, and the convicts came to the house, and she hid and came back out. And she grabbed this axe, and this axe, when you chop somebody's head off with it, the head stays alive and talks to you. And like, hey, there's my body over there. What did you do to me? This really sucks.
Because I was thinking they need to be like the governor and just put the damn heads in an aquarium and watch them.
And so it's really coming down to a whole... You know, the story's fleshed out, obviously, by issue 5, but...
Alan Grimes is watching. Hi, Alan.
Nice. What's up, sir?
You interrupted.
Blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Now it's getting into, you know, there's more to the story. The heads are talking to her and telling her, you know, what's going on. There's some double cross going on in your normal... You know,
so if you chop somebody's head off, you can't like trust the head afterwards?
Yeah. No. Well,
that's interesting.
No, not from the heads. It's from other people in the story.
Like, gotcha.
That.
So the heads are trustworthy.
Yes, the heads are trustworthy. Thank goodness. But I think she's got two heads. So it's not really a basketful of heads. It's only like a couple right now. Like, but they are in a basket.
That's like false advertising.
There might be 3 at this point.
I expect least 4 heads if it's called a basket full of heads.
Let me get there on that last. It maybe there are. I only remember there might be 3. 2 at least, possibly 3. But no, I'm digging it. I mean, it's, you know, it's so hard to do horror in comic books, like to scare you, you know what I mean? Like, you're not going to get scared. Well, at least not me. I mean, it's got to be really...
Because you're unscarable?
No, it's just with the whole, like, you know, you get a creepy movie or a creepy, you know...
It's amazing how important music is when it comes to, like, horror movies.
Yeah.
Yes, that suspense. Yeah, and
but I think,
else.
You know, it's a good story. It's just, it's not, like...
I always felt that way about books, too. Like, everybody would tell me, oh, this Stephen King book is so scary. I'm like... Can you really be scared by a book? You can just
stop
you can
it.
Just stop reading at any point.
Right. I think when I...
I guess you can turn a movie off, but it's not quite the same.
I think the first time I read it, it was creepy. Like, but it didn't, like, scare me, but it was... It got close.
When I compare reading a Stephen King book to watching The Shining, it's night and day, man. It's not even close to the same thing.
Yeah, The Shining's awful.
Jesus.
It did not age well.
The Shining?
The Shining did not.
What? It's a classic. What are you talking about?
Yeah, and I watched it too late in life. It did not age well.
It's supposed to be... I haven't seen it for a while, but it's Stanley Kubrick, man. All his movies age well.
But it has a lot of
problems. You watch Dr. Strangelove yet? It's a great movie.
I still haven't watched that one. But I did watch Dr. Sleep. Is that the one?
That's a sequel. The new Shining.
Yeah, it's a sequel to The Shining. It's actually pretty good. It's not too bad.
But you think The Shining is crap?
I did not like it. Let's put it that way. I could see why a lot of people at the time probably did, but like I said,
could you at least appreciate like the directing and the cinematography? And
yeah,
the,
yeah.
The filmmaking,
some of that, yeah. But it was it's got a very 80s type of soundtrack or something. I mean, yeah. It is just really there you go, talking about soundtracks. It almost takes away from the beauty of the film because it is just so annoying now of how they're trying to put suspense in with this big organ, like, you know, whatever. It's just, oh. But, yes, there is some good filmmaking and other things done throughout that.
Scott's,
sorry.
It's bringing me down.
I know.
Anyway.
All right.
Good. You talking about it anymore?
It's good. Now.
You sure?
Yeah.
Wow. All right, it's your turn, Scott. Do a retro review. Since you were
retro
type
things.
Have any new stuff.
Yeah, that's okay. I mean, I've been busy, you know, what, watching movies, playing games, this type of stuff, you know, and things. Reading lots of rules for games. So that kind of takes away from some of that. Yep. Why the Last Man, Volume 2.
Volume 2.
Cycles. So.
Sickles.
You know, I'm pretty sure as I'm reading through this that I did not. I bought a lot of the trades as they came out.
Yeah.
Okay. So while it's 10 trades total, when I started buying, you know, 1 and 2 and 3, 10 was not out yet, you know, and stuff. 9 and 10 weren't out there. So I remember reading this, you know, and going, okay, I'd read it. And then I'd have to wait, you know, freaking six months before the next trade and stuff. And so then when I got to the 10th one, I didn't go back and read all of them. I just read it. I don't think I've gone back and read this thing since then. Because I'm reading this one. And
you're surprised again, aren't you?
Somewhat surprised, but there's some things there where I'm going, this is kind of foreshadowing a little bit, you know, maybe in some different things, you know, and stuff. I think I should have, you know, picked up on that before. But, you know, now I'm realizing, you know, after reading this one in particular, I'm going, I don't think I've ever gone back to reread this after I collected the whole thing. So, because that's like, oh.
I should read them with you. I have those hardcovers.
So yeah. Anyway, in this one...
I don't remember hardly anything about this book. I read it as it came out in single issues.
You know, that's the thing. Is that I remember a lot.
Or the hardcovers, and I remember nothing.
I remember a lot from the start, and I remember how it ended. But I'm with you. I don't remember a lot of the stuff in between. So, but yes, in this one in particular... You know, at the end of the first one, they kind of wrap up things to basically it's introducing your main characters. You know, you're introducing Yorick, you know, your last man, 355, which is his kind of protector, bodyguard or whatever, you know, type thing. And then you got Dr. Man, who's kind of the clone geneticist, you know, type of thing person. Well, at the end of the first volume there, first six issues or whatever, they get to Dr. Man. Yeah, they introduce her, you know, and stuff. They're at her, you know, what would you say, lab. Yeah, they're in New York, and it gets burned down, okay? Well, all the rest of her information is in California. So, of course, now it's road trip, you know, time. So this is starting essentially the road trip. They basically get onto a train. They stop off in Ohio. They find out that there's this beautiful little town there that's basically made up of a lot of ex-convict women type things. But... they're sharp enough, they've lived without men long enough and things of this nature that they can get things back on like electricity and keeping things clean and whatever the hell else. And so it's kind of a bit of a utopia and things there. Meanwhile, the Yorick's sister Hero is an Amazon and is caught on his tail trying to kill the last man. So
she doesn't know it's Yorick.
She doesn't know it's Yorick, but she finds out in this particular section then. So in this trade. That is Yorick. But she still doesn't care. She's been kind of brainwashed and whatnot. And I think there was probably some things there in their past where they make mention, you know, of who thought who was daddy's favorite, you know, or whatever else type stuff. So it was a little bit of sibling rivalry. There you go.
Rivalry.
But it's still good. It moves at a quick pace, but, you know, it kind of introduces a little bit of, you know, the tragedy and things that's in this, you know, post-apocalyptic world, you know, and stuff. And in particular, people that Yorick gets attached to, you know, in different ways, you know, and things, and how he has to deal with that tragedy and things like that. So you still have your main characters there, but it's kind of like these side ones, you know, that get introduced and are gone, you know, in a lot of ways. So, and I think that may be a bit of a reoccurring theme, if I remember right, throughout some of the series, you know, in different ways. But it's still good, solid, and yeah, it's a quick read. It, you could tell it's almost, you know, I'm surprised that they haven't made something, you know,
they're trying.
I know, a series or something on it. I mean, it just has that feel of something that could be put into a series pretty easily.
Very cinematic.
Especially after the stuff that they've done to date, you know, like Walking Dead and some of these others, you know, with the streaming services and things. So, definitely recommend it. Still just as good the second time around.
Cool.
That's good. Did you read Plunge? Is that in there?
I read number one. I haven't read number two. Oh,
that's lame.
But I read the first one, so I can kind of...
We could do one and two.
I can do one and you can do two.
Alright, you do one.
If I remember even what it's about.
Plunge one and two.
So, okay, I think I do.
It's about a boat.
Yeah.
They're going to look for a boat.
Yeah, they're going to look for a boat. So there's a ship that disappeared like 40 years ago.
Yeah, sounds about right.
Somewhere off the coast of... Well, it's up by Russia, I think.
Yeah, because they didn't want to go.
Because they didn't want to go.
Russia seawater, or Russia water.
And so this company that owned the boat, it had some kind of...
black box.
New technology, like breaking technology at the time. Groundbreaking technology at the time. And so it just disappeared, like off the... disappeared off radar, off of everything, just suddenly, and then it just came back like 40 years later. Like
they got a signal.
The signal came back, and so the company goes to hire this guy, like a ragtag crew, like just one guy and like three crewmen or whatever. That stealth technology
just like made it totally disappear for real, right?
Something.
Well, yeah, something. And so they end up hiring them to go and get this, to go get this boat. And I can't remember if they get onto the boat, like, in the first issue.
I think they find the boat and they end up, like, on an island, don't they?
I don't remember. What happens in happens in the second one?
That's a good question.
But that stays the second one.
That's the
so setup. They're on an island, they found the boat, and they're basically exploring the island. They're finding mysterious things on the island, and they kind of split up like any good horror movie. Oh. You know, some guys stay on the island, do some investigation. Some guys go back to the boat because they find like a dead body. I think that happens at the end of the first issue.
Oh, okay.
They find like a dead body.
Let me see that. And this one's written by Joe Hill too. No, mine. Let me see the first one.
because it's good.
Joe Hill's not writing all the series. He's just writing the Basketful Heads, and then I think Plunge. So
wow. But yeah, by issue two, it feels like a very typical but well-written like horror movie. You know, it's like you got this crew, they start to, you know, they find a dead body, you know, weird things start happening.
They're on
split up, and
yeah, they go to the island and find it, and it's got like some weird bugs, like some bugs crawling in its neck or whatever.
So but yeah, this second issue,
they talk.
There's a lot
the
of
bugs talk.
Yeah, it says it's all right if you need to scream, Mariah.
Yeah, I won't spoil too much, but in the second issue, they take that body back to the ship.
Gotcha.
And the body comes alive.
I was going to say, it sounds like the thing here.
It starts sabotaging, basically, the ship.
It's like, oh my God. Haven't they watched any movies before?
And a few of them
say, never take it back to the ship. Alien, the thing.
And a few of them stay on the island to investigate further, and one guy finds like a cave that he like goes down by himself to investigate, while the other people are up above. So yeah, I mean, it's like every horror movie trope, but like I said, the characters are pretty well written. I mean, they all have a distinct voice, and he has a cool, like, you know, little, you know, each character feels distinct or whatever, right. And I'd say. It's like a good horror movie.
Yeah. I think...
I enjoy the art because it's Stuart Eminem or whatever.
Those two series, even though I've only read like the first issue of Plunge, but I'm almost done with Basketful of Heads. Like, out of all the series that I'm reading, like, those two are more horror. Like, you know what I mean? Like, they're more... They seem more horror-y to me. I mean, like, they seem like the same vein.
Yeah.
The other ones are just kind of like, they're creepy. They're not really horror. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, I don't know. I'm not really explaining it very well.
No, I think you are. Think you
those two kind of stand out, anyway.
Cool. I'll do a couple of quick ones here.
And that's not to slight the other ones, because I'm enjoying them. They're just...
It's just a different type.
Yeah.
I read Folklords 5. It's the end of the series.
That's number 5? I didn't even know you're buying that.
I was not impressed with the series at all. It just felt like, I don't know, it just didn't really go anywhere.
Right.
It's just kind of wandering. I'm just like, by the end, you're like, what was even the point? It's over. I don't even care. I hope there's not more.
That's great.
Those are Matt Kent.
It's Matt Kent writes it, but yeah.
And Matt Smith draws it, who I like both those guys, but it just didn't feel interesting at all.
I passed on that series just because when I read the initial solicit, It was the same thing. It's like, well, this just seems more of the same. It doesn't seem like anything groundbreaking. Like, does it need to exist? Like, why is it? I didn't even want to try it.
I like Matt Kent usually, and so I pretty much just, I used to just buy anything he does.
Right.
But lately, I think I'm going to have to start being more discerning because I just didn't dig it. I mean, it wasn't bad. It just didn't really scratch any kind of itches
right.
that I was interested in. But I mean, like I said... Usagi Yojimbo. I'm buying the color classics and new stuff. Right. So I've got.
Did you
three
see
of the
that,
color
that,
classics?
That
and
color then, classics. They turned it into a limited series now. There's seven of them.
Yeah,
six of them.
They're cool though. It's nice seeing the old stories kind of colorized. They're doing the classic. They did like his origin. They're doing like his backstory. So it's pretty cool if you're like. If you've never read any Usagi Yojimbo and you're starting on a new series, this kind of gives you some cool, like, his origin story, kind of, and some of the early stuff. I mean, but, it's cool. And then the main series is pretty cool, too. I'm still enjoying it. It seems like it's... The first arc, I wasn't, like, super excited about the story, but it seems like as it's gone, it's gotten a little more interesting, exciting.
Cool.
Ninjas are in there, and there's a little more intrigue, and I don't know, it's Usagi Yojimbo.
Yeah.
You either like it or you don't, but it's good stuff.
I usually save those up and read them in a big chunk, so.
It's like strange, because most of them actually read pretty well as single issues.
Yeah.
You just have two more?
I have three. But they'll go quick.
All right. Grindel, Devil's Odyssey is still really good. It's Matt Wagner art. He's stuck on... He keeps finding... It's kind of like Star Trek. Like, every... couple issues he finds like a new planet and just and kind of runs into the inhabitants and has to like fight through the problems or whatever. This one got a little violent, but as you saw those intestines sprawled against the screen. But cool. Grindel's cool. I like Grindel, and I like futuristic Grindel way more than I like modern day Grindel, so this is right up my alley. So
cool.
Because Grindel has, like, a lightsaber, Scott, so that makes it that much better.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Everything's better with a lightsaber.
Exactly. All right, I'll take a break there.
All right, I'll do Dollhouse. So I read the first one. So this is 2, 3, and 4.
You should have just saved these up and done them all at once.
Yeah, I know, but I... See, I thought...
Now you have to give us the whole concept again, like we already did that last week. Or last 2 weeks ago.
That is an interesting cover.
I won't jump into the concept. Do you want the concept?
Nope.
Okay, but so the concept of this book is, so it's really, it's playing in two different timelines.
Oh,
so you've got like the
cool.
like early 1800s and then you have like the 1980s. So the girl in the 1980s, her parents, her dad's a bad dude. Like, he beats his mom and he drinks and gambles, blah, blah, blah. He's just not a great guy. Well, they get a dollhouse gets delivered to their house.
Oh, yeah, I remember this one.
Yeah, and it was like from some long-lost ancestor of the wife. And so they have a little kid, a daughter, and so they give the dollhouse to the daughter. Well, the dollhouse is full of dolls, but she goes down into the dollhouse and like plays in the dollhouse And but there's like a black room in the dollhouse, and it's like a sinister force or whatever that tries
don't
to
don't go into the black right. room.
And so
you may do whatever you want, just don't go into the black room.
Right. And so at the end of issue one,
and so of course at the end of issue one, she's got to go into the black room.
Right. And the dollhouse tells her that she needs to kill her dad. And so she does.
Oh yeah, I remember this.
Right. And this so then the her issue. Mom her mom gets. Takes the blame for it, basically. Her mom takes the hit for it. And so she goes to prison.
Would you take the hit for your kids if they killed your spouse?
Probably. I don't know. Wow. Maybe. I don't know. So anyway, she goes to prison, and the girl goes to an orphanage. Well, the dollhouse goes with her, and it's not a nice orphanage like, you know, most orphanages are portrayed. Like, yeah, it's an all-girl nice. Orphanage, but they're all mean. Like, they beat up on her.
What?
And do all this crazy stuff. The mom ends up dying in prison, and then one of the kids that's always picking on her, the daughter, she goes into the dollhouse, and she's there forever, I guess. So
no.
She finally gets out of the orphanage. She has like a one night stand with this dude. She gets pregnant. She doesn't tell the guy that she's pregnant at all. They just met each other one time, and she doesn't track him down. So she has her own daughter, and she brings her daughter up.
Does she give her the
all by herself? Yes, the dollhouse comes back or whatever. So they'll go back in time. Well, the guy that's the dad of the family, it's not a real family, they're just like a mishmash of characters that live in this house, but they act like they're a family. Like, there's a dad, there's a mom, and there's kids, but they're not married, you know what I mean? Like, it's not a family. And so the dad,
how many families did you
is actually say? The guy from the 1800s that built the dollhouse. It's like his kid or something. Like, something happened. So the dollhouse tries to suck in kids. The black room tries to suck in kids.
Okay.
And then they live in the dollhouse. But they have to get them to do something like kill your dad or whatever. That's how they try to get them, like they win them over. So anyway, back in when she's married or when she has her daughter, she gets into a car wreck. And she goes into a coma and she wakes up and she lost her leg. And the little girl lost her arm. So they each have prosthetics. Well, she was in a coma for like 6 weeks. Well, somehow the hospital contacted her dad. The guy that was the dad that hasn't even met the daughter.
Yeah.
So he comes back into the picture and he's like been taking care of the daughter. And then when she gets out of the hospital, they're kind of hanging out kind of thing. Well, the house comes back, the black room comes back and tells the mom that they tell her that if she goes into the house, they will heal her daughter. They'll fix her arm, she'll be fine.
Okay.
And the mom's like, no, I'm not going to do that. She's like, we'll be okay on our own, blah, blah, blah. Well, then, so she's in bed and the husband, they start to get back together and they're getting ready to go to bed. And she's like, oh, my prosthetic's really itching. And she looks down and her leg has been healed. So that's where it ends. The little girl, so the house made a deal to the little girl. Hey, if you come live in our house, we'll fix your mom. And the little girl took it. So that's where it ended. So
that's where, and look, it's a girl with a broken leg on the cover.
Yeah. That's the mom, and the little girl has a broken arm, probably.
Ooh.
That's awesome. Yep, see, broken arm.
I got it.
Broken leg.
I got it.
But anyway, that's where that series is.
Oh, I got it.
You got it?
I got it.
Dude, you should be excited that I actually remember stuff. Usually I can't even remember anything. That's true. And now when I remember stuff, now you're giving me crap about that.
I thought you were good.
I read Outpost Zero, which is an image series. I had it bound up.
Yeah.
Thingamajobber.
Did you end up enjoying this?
I did. I mean, it definitely works better reading it all at once. The basic concept is there's this big ship of human civilization that, like, crash-landed on this planet, like, I don't know, hundreds of years ago. And So they've basically been living inside this crashed ship on this planet because the planet is inhospitable to life. And they don't have the technology to get the ship running again. They don't have the technology to colonize any more of the planet. So they're basically just in this sort of dome, bubble, ship thing trying to survive for hundreds of years. And so they've created their own little society that lets them kind of
divergent.
Keep subsisting or whatever to maintain, and they, you know, people get married, they have more kids. So there's been generations here. But it's basically following this group of kids who are kind of at the, they're just getting old enough to where they start, like, they're finished secondary school and they're going to do their apprenticeship to figure out what their job is going to be in this society. But the kids are all kind of teenagers and they're just kind of trying to navigate this very unique situation where they're, it's not like you can move away, you know, they're stuck here, you know, and they don't have a lot of options. And so that's kind of the theme of the book is, you know, being young, being stuck in one place, not really having a lot of options.
Who's the artist on this?
The artist is somebody who I've never heard of. It is Alexandra Tevenki.
Hmm.
But the writer is Sean Kelly McKeever, and I've always enjoyed his stuff. He writes young people pretty well.
Okay.
But anyway, it was pretty good. I mean, the series starts out with one of the kids in the group decides to basically go through the airlock out into the hostile environment and dies.
Into the unknown.
So he basically commits suicide. And so the kids are trying to figure out why he committed suicide through most of the book, trying to figure out, one, how he got out the airlock because it's supposed to be secured, and then two, why he did what he did because he seemed perfectly fine. And so there's a group of them, and of course there's kids within the group that don't like each other, and so there's some internal conflict, and it's interesting. I mean, there's some cool, like, it gets kind of like Alien, you know, they run to like an alien on the planet and they start communicating with it, that kind of thing. They find like a cool old robot or whatever that can talk to them that has artificial intelligence, so it's got some cool little things.
Did you feel like they had to really start speeding up towards the end in order to kind of wrap it all up? Or
a little bit. I'm sure it could have gone further, but I felt like they must have had enough of a notice that the book was ending soon enough that it didn't feel rushed to me. It felt fairly compact.
Fairly
decent. I mean, obviously
pace.
It could have kept going and there was a little bit of kind of compressing at the end maybe, but I felt it worked pretty well as a self-contained type story. So it wasn't too bad. Because you always worry about that if they have to rush. Cram it all in.
Yeah.
But it didn't feel like that too much. I mean, it's not quite as... doesn't feel quite as planned out as like something like Paper Girls or something where you can tell that... You know, Brian K. Vaughan can make that story as long as he wants it to be, right? Because he's got the sales. He can tell exactly the story he wants to tell. It didn't quite feel like that, but it definitely felt... You got some closure and stuff.
Cool. So I might swipe this one.
All right, cool.
I thought you read that.
Read the first couple of them.
Gotcha.
It's a slow burn, so it's not really ideal to read like that.
So yeah, it probably will be mean that I'll like know exactly, you know, nothing will have left off. I can just jump right to like last one and go, oh yeah.
What do you got, two?
Yeah, I was thinking, you ever read Sweet Tooth?
Yeah, I have read.
Oh, okay.
Probably like the first trade I think that you had.
Okay.
So, cool. I'm familiar with it.
I was going to say, if you wanted to read it, I'd give it to you, and then we'd just talk about it next week.
Nah. All right. It's all good.
I have two. I think Scott should probably go, because
he only has one.
I only got the one.
All right, it's fine. I'll talk about it.
Okay.
No, you do one. I just did one.
All right. I'll do... This one will go real fast, because...
It will.
It will. The Low, Low Woods. Because I remember a little bit about it, but it's not like one of my favorite. There's some creepy creatures that live in the woods.
I'm kidding.
All right.
No. I thought Dom might do that.
All right. So
creepy critters in the woods.
It's already taking longer.
So there's this town in Pennsylvania. It's a mining town. And have you guys ever heard? I think this is loosely based. Like, I remember somewhere in Pennsylvania where the town caught on fire. And it's, like, still burning. Like, it's been burning for, like, 30, 40 years. And, like, everybody had to leave.
Would they have a tire plant?
No, it's all coal, like, under the ground.
Oh, cool.
Like, it caught on fire, and it's just been burning and burning.
I hadn't
and they
heard
can't
about
put
that.
It out. You've never heard of that?
I had heard of something weird like that.
Scott thinks he's
heard. So, anyway, that's the premise. This city, this town is, like, that town, kind of, sort of. But, so, It's a coal mining town in Pennsylvania. Everybody's poor. Nobody knows how to do anything else. The mine that caught on fire and it's still burning, so it's not safe to mine anymore, but people still stick around. And so there's these two girls. They're best friends. They're like besties. Teenagers.
BFF.
But the weird thing is, like, everybody... So they're both gay, but they're not, like, together. They're just friends.
Friends.
And this other girl, it seems like a really small town to have a lot of lesbians in it. Because there's another girl in the high school that the one girl is, like, dating. But she doesn't really want people to know that she's gay, I guess. And so she's kind of skittish. So they kind of break up kind of thing. But the whole thing kind of, like, this is all kind of backstory. But the whole thing, so there's these woods. And they've always told the kids to stay out of the woods. And so, like, they flash back to, like, when they were kids and they go into the woods. I think it was when they met. And, like, some weird creature, like, comes after them and they run away and don't tell anybody. And so now it flashes back to, like, now, and they're, like, hanging out. Because they get in a fight over something. I don't remember. And then one of them's in the woods.
Oh,
and
there's some type of weird,
and then there's, like, yeah, some kind of weird thing. Weird deer thing. And then later on, there's, like, almost like a humanoid creature or whatever that comes after them in the woods. But... That's about it. I'm not really sure where this one's going yet. After three issues, I don't really have a handle on it.
Especially the fact that she's got like a black hole in her stomach.
Oh, yeah. That girl, that's why. Because the one that's a girlfriend, she's like, who's skittish. The reason she's skittish is because she has like a black hole.
In her stomach?
In her stomach, yeah. And it's hereditary because her mom...
Has one as well.
Because she freaks out. And kicks her out, and then she comes back and talks to her later, and she's like, yeah, I have to show you something. Because she can usually control it, I guess. But during the day. Right, her black hole.
Did you read another book about like a dude with a black hole in his stomach?
Collapse her or something, yeah.
And I said, you can't have a black hole in your stomach?
Well, I don't know that it's a black hole, it's just like something freaky.
Physics says no.
But, well, this is comic books. It's just like TV, dude.
Kind of like Captain.
But anyway, that's she kind of freaks out, and so she has...
physics at all.
Her mom can't control it, so, like, her mom's just been, like, bedridden for, like, 20 years with, like, laying in bed with this black hole, like, half of her gone.
Look at that cover. That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
So, huh. Anyway. Interesting.
That's the Lolo Woods.
Apparently, not one of the better ones,
not one of my more favorite, but it's all right.
But still could be solid.
Yeah.
We'll see.
Ah, Sweet Tooth. This is by Jeff Lemire. I read, like, a couple trades. This is the first hardcover. There's three hardcovers. I think there's six trades. I'm pretty sure I've read everything that was in here.
How many
I've been meaning to buy the hardcovers. It's 12 issues. I
12, so it goes to 36. I can't remember.
I think so. It might only be 10. I don't freaking know, but there's three of them. Okay. Yeah, it's 12 issues. Three hardcovers.
So somewhere around 36. 35 to 40 issues or something. Yeah.
I don't know.
This book was so good.
So, I always get to read this. I started buying the trades. I
never read the whole thing. Just
then I saw they had deluxe editions, so I was going to do those. I had them, like, in my cart on, like, a website that I order a lot of my trades from, and then number one was out of stock. But they still had two and three. I'm like, well, that doesn't do me any good. So then I found another website that still had one in stock. So I was buying some other stuff from that website, so I went ahead and added this on there.
Pulled the trigger, huh?
And bought it. And then I checked, like, a few days later, and that website was now sold out of volume one. So I agree that we'll be back in print because apparently this has been picked up by Robert Downey Jr.'s production company and they are fast-tracking the hell out of this to make a TV show.
Really?
Or are they?
They even
That's worth $400.
They even have actors attached to it, so I'm sure it will be back in print. And I guess Jeff Lemire announced just this week that he's doing more Sweet Tooth.
Oh, cool.
I don't know how.
Well, yeah, I guess I do know how.
So anyway, the premise of the book is that there's a big virus. Apparently every book starts with a virus, mm-hmm. which is weird in today's day and age. But anyway, so the virus starts killing everybody, and then everybody who has children, who gets pregnant or, you know, has children after the virus hits, their children come out as like these half-human, half-animal hybrids is what they call them. And so Sweet Tooth has been living in the woods with his supposed parents, and... his dad dies and he's all on his own. Well, some people come looking for him and some big gruff dude comes and kind of rescues him and says, I'm going to take you to a nice place where they take you people and they kind of give you a place to live. It's, I don't know, he has like a name for it, but it's some like sanctuary,
a reserve sanctuary
where he can be safe and all that. And so he takes him there and this dude's like a badass and they run into some people on the way and he just mows through him because he can kill anybody and he's like a tough dude. Anyway, so he takes him to the sanctuary. Well, when they get there, instead of it being this nice place, it's more like a lab, and he turns him over to him and basically sells him to him.
Right.
And they hand him a big duffel bag of something that they give him in exchange for Sweet Tooth handing him over. So then the next arc is basically Sweet Tooth being in this lab, and it turns out that Sweet Tooth does not have a belly button. And the scientist guy who's trying to figure out what the hell's going on with these hybrids and how it relates to the virus, he's amazed by that because Sweet Tooth says he's like 9 and the virus hit like 7 years ago. He's like, well, that's not possible if you're only 9. And then he looks and he doesn't have a belly button. He's like, you weren't born, dude, because you don't have a belly button. You don't have an umbilical cord. Maybe you started this virus. Maybe you're like, maybe they cloned you or did some kind of weird hybrid and you started the virus. So he's trying to figure it out. So the dude's like doing all these experiments on Sweet Tooth, trying to, I think he puts him in hypnosis and tries to like have him look back and try and like get like information out of him because he can't remember, you know, he's trying to get stuff. So while that's going on, the dude who turned him over, well, we get his backstory. Apparently, he was kind of like a hockey player. Jeff Lemire loves hockey players. Mm-hmm. He was like an aging hockey player, and he was basically the brawler of the team. And after a while, that's all he could do was fight. He couldn't actually play that well anymore. Anyway, he had this wife that he loved, and when the virus hit, they kind of went on the road, and they were trying to kind of, well, his wife got pregnant, right? And then they got taken in by these same people who are now doing experiments on Sweet Tooth, and they got kind of, they said they were friendly, and of course they went with him, and then they got there, and they ripped his wife away and threw him in like a jail cell or whatever, because they wanted, his wife was pregnant, and they wanted to see what she, they wanted to do experiments on her to see what she gave birth to, blah, blah, blah. Well, she dies in childbirth, and this guy gets pissed and he's still in the cage. You say, well, you know, if you can bring us a hybrid, we'll give you your wife's bones or whatever. And that's what he was doing. He was getting a hybrid so he could exchange that to have his wife's bones so he could take her bones home to like put them in the ground at her house so that she could be at rest, like where she grew up or whatever. And so that was his thing. Well, then at the end of the book, he does that and he feels like he just wants to die because he's done what he wanted to do. But then he's like, well, then he kind of has like a tinge of conscience or whatever. And then he kind of is on a tear to go and get Sweet Tooth back. So that's how the second arc ends, is he's going to go.
He's ready to break him out.
Rescue Sweet Tooth because he feels bad for what he did. And he did what he wanted to do with his wife's bones and stuff. So that kind of where it leaves us. But it's really well done. It's Jeff Lemire. It's, you know, good stuff.
Mm-hmm. So that's cool. Yeah. I didn't buy the single issues because I didn't get into it late either, but I bought all the trades.
Yeah.
And then when they solicited a hardcover, I thought about buying it, but because I really liked the story, but I was like, I was kind of past the point of like double and triple dipping.
Yeah,
and I'm just like, I have the trades. I'm like, I'm not going to buy the hardcover. So I opted out on that.
Yeah.
But it's a nice presentation. I like the. Yeah, I like the. Like I said, I like that version that DC does with those books.
There's a few of these Vertigo series which I feel like I'll go back and read a few times, so I don't mind having them a hardcover because I kind of like having it in a nicer book.
Yeah, and then they give you like little extras and stuff.
I don't really care about the extras that much. I mean, I just want to have something else. You know how I tear up trade paperbacks, so if there's an option, trade paperback and a hardcover, I'd always take the hardcover because they don't fall apart in my hands. Like
exactly.
Cool.
You want me to go? Or what do
you got?
Go?
You got one left?
Yeah, I got one left.
We all got one left.
Oh my gosh. I read
Sandman. You were bored.
It wasn't bored. It was just looking what I hadn't read for a while on my shelf, you know, type
Sandman
things.
Sandman Library.
Yep. Yeah, of course, Prelude, this is like the 12th printing, I think, of Sandman or something like that, probably, you know, type things. No, it is the 12th printing, so, yeah.
Well, I was looking.
But they're probably like in like the freaking 30th printing. Yeah. Do you know my Why Last Man? It's first printing.
Nice.
Ooh, yeah. So, but anyway.
Bank.
Yeah, whatever. There we go.
You've got that, and Drew has the first printing of Sweet Tooth.
We're set. So, this starts off the Neil Gaiman Sandman series, which I don't know how many issues it was. Probably around 60. 75? Okay.
Were there 10 trades?
There was 10 trades. Right. That's why I was going, it's probably somewhere
around. So 7.5 issues.
There's 4 right absolutes.
Is there? Wow. Do you have them all?
Three.
You do have all the absolutes. Now, are you a Sandman fan then? No. Or did you just buy it? Well, that's what I wondered. I mean, did you just buy it because, wow, I like Damon?
He buys all the absolutes.
I don't. He used to. I really don't. I used to buy. So I have like one and two. I have issue one and two of Sandman. Because this came out like when I was in high school.
Oh, yeah.
I was like probably 16 or 17. And it wasn't really what I was into. You know what I mean? Like it was above my head, probably, or just not what I was into.
It's still above my head.
Right,
so.
Right. But a friend of mine that I was in high school with, he had some of them, and I got into it. But I never bought all of them. And it was always something that everybody's like, oh, you have to read it, you have to read it. And they came out with the absolutes, and I love the absolutes. And I think it was, I had some money laying, or like I got a bonus at work, or a tax refund, or a birthday, or something. And they were all there, so I dropped the cash on the absolutes so that I could read it.
Wow. It's...
I like the series.
It's good.
I've only read it one time.
Right.
All the way through.
I
need to go
you.
Back and reread it.
I think again. I've only read it one time all the way through from 1 through 10. I would pick them up, you know, gradually, you know. I haven't gone back, you know, and read them all probably again. The one that I've probably read the most is probably Volume 1. In different ways, just because there's some things I think that come back to it in a way.
I like Seasons of the Mist. That's probably one of my favorite, is the Seasons of the Mist.
I couldn't even tell you what happens in any of them. That's been
I
so
think
long
it's Seasons of
them.
The Mist. Isn't
that, yeah, that's
well, this
to
is
hell.
Cool.
He goes to hell.
It does tell you the all these ones in here, but... yeah.
It's the one where he goes to Lucifer. That's a good one. Seasons of the Mist.
Well, yeah, but the that's probably quits. True. We're probably there having
he has
to
take over hell.
Yeah,
right?
I was going to say, because they have the whole... This kind of sets up some of that because of the fact that there's an issue in this one where he has to go to hell to get his mask back. So overall, this is introducing Neil Gaiman's version of Sandman. Okay,
and Sam Keith does the artwork, like in the first
three.
View?
They say, yeah. You know, I think he actually did some maybe layouts all the way maybe to six, but you can definitely tell that there's a break there somewhere. Sam Keith is his artwork is. So incredible for this type of story. And you can tell then kind of where it changes there over.
Do they have the double page spread where they show hell? Is that in this?
There is a
on?
Double page spread where
I
they
saw like the original artwork. They had the original artwork for that for sale like years ago.
Oh, really?
And it was like $30,000 or something like years ago. But that's a cool.
So the overall spread. Gist of this though is that. Sandman is a character. He's a person, you know, type thing. He's one of the endless.
He's Dream.
So he is Dream. That's right.
Morpheus.
And known by many names, but one of them is Dream. And the idea is that he's the person that helps, you know, bring dreams, you know, nightmares, that kind of whole, you know, other universe in a way, you know, of things. Well, you really, you know that... He's one of this endless that really starts off with some humans that are into the occult and things of this nature. They're after to try to capture death. And it turns out they actually capture Dream instead. And they keep him, they go, okay, well, we'll try to use him to see if we can get death. And we'll, you know, keep him kept in this bubble, you know, glass type thing until he talks. And he's like, fuck, I'm one of the endless. Shit, I don't care. You guys just outlive y'all, you know, type things. So he spends the better part of like 70 years in this damn jar or something to that close, maybe 60 or so, before somebody makes a mistake and, you know, they break the seal, so to speak, that he's, in, you know, encased in and he's able to get out and basically try to have revenge, you know, on whatever. But part of the thing is he had a couple tools when he got captured, you know. In particular, he's got his little pouch of sand, you know, to try to help with dreams. He's got a mask, and he also has a, like, different jewel, ruby necklace type of thing. That has, and each one of these tools have some of his power involved in them. So a lot of what this first series is him trying to regain those tools that he lost when he got captured. And kind of introducing some of the supernatural that goes with it. And in particular, then he gets all of his tools back. And then the last issue in this one kind of introduces his sister, who is Death. And they have a conversation, you know, about, you know, what are they doing, you know, and stuff of this nature and what he should be doing next. So it's very, it's Neil Gaiman. He's a great war writer. I mean, part of the problem I have in some of this is it can be very dense in some parts. Mm-hmm. You know, he likes a lot of symbology type things in trying to not maybe let the reader, he doesn't just spell things out. You know, he wants to try to throw these little hidden phrases, you know, bring up works from other authors, maybe whatever it is, you know, type things. And
kind of Alan Moore-ish.
Yeah. But I mean, you feel that in a different way. I mean, it's, you got the, a lot of those English guys, Grant, you know, Morrison. All the time. Grant Morrison, Alan Moore. Golly, there was somebody else in that time frame too. I don't remember that they even referenced to, but you know, it's kind of in that next great, you know, kind of author in some of that. You know, it's interesting because you can tell some of this, you know, was him trying to gain his footing. You know, maybe the Neil was more of a, they even say that he'd written a little bit in comics, but not a whole lot. This was his, really his first longer series. He tried to, you know, to try to write something that maybe had showed that it was part of the DC universe. You know, there's like a little cameo from Martian Manhunter. There's a little thing of Constantine in there. You know, some of this where he's like, okay, see, I'm part of this universe, but I really don't know what the hell I'm writing with these comic book characters. I really want to just focus on mine, you know, type thing. So a lot of it is set up to show I'm part of this universe. Here's who my character is. And by the time that you get to that last issue, it's like, oh, you kind of can start telling now that he's got his own world building that he wants to do, you know, and really this is different than, say, a superhero universe type of thing, you know. And I just felt like by the time you get to that last issue, it's him trying to, okay, I've got that shit out of the way. Now here's the story I want to tell. And it's almost, you know, it is the prelude, you know, almost to some more.
Yeah, he was Vertigo, but I mean, this was Vertigo.
Well, this is before Vertigo. Yeah, right. There's a nice stuff they talk about.
Into Vertigo, but this was really the first Vertigo.
Well, they talk about that in the forward of this, you know, and basically that it was before Vertigo and that they helped this use this essentially to help them launch that Vertigo imprint.
They're like, this works, that's so right. we're going to do a whole series. And then they backed this into Vertigo. I mean, they sucked it in.
Yeah. But now, what's interesting is that the foreword, I think, is from, like, what, the editor or something like that.
Karen Berger.
Yeah,
it's kind of important.
Yeah, who, you know, kind of talks a little bit about, yeah, hey, we had these conversations. Here's how we got started and things. And then the back, it has a conversation with Neil in which a lot of, you know, crossover there in, you know, certain respects. They both kind of said, yeah, they're in the middle. They kind of faltered at this one. But, you know, you could tell definitely by the end and the introduction of Death that he had a greater story to tell. And, you know, the fact of Sam Keith, who also, I guess, at that point in time, wasn't doing much full comic art, you know, type stuff.
That was probably some of his very first work.
It sounded like it, and he wasn't totally prepared for this, and so that's why he made some mention that he's like, I feel like I'm the wrong, you know, drummer in the wrong band or something like this, you know, type thing.
Didn't Sam Keith do like Dragon Force or something? Was that like his first work? Who was it that was
Dragon?
Dale Keown. Okay,
yeah.
So this might have been Sam Keith's first stuff.
If he did anything, it was something small.
Something small in there, maybe.
After that, he started doing some stuff for Marvel, and then he kind of developed a style. This doesn't really look like Sam Keith.
No, you get a little bit of it.
It's him, but I mean, he develops it more.
He develops it, and he goes more cartoony.
Yeah.
He goes real more. I mean, that's the only way to describe it. It is more, like, the Max is more cartoony. And, you know, some of his other stuff, like his Marvel stuff, like Wolverine, like in Marvel Comics Presents, like all those covers, I mean, they're really cartoony.
Very stylized. Yeah.
I
agree.
But yeah.
He isn't quite there.
Yeah.
I don't know, though. I felt like his art, though, even in this, though, in that early part, is
It does look like him.
It's good. Just feels so dark in whatever else with this story that he's telling, that it just works so well with this whole almost revenge, you know, and hey, I'm getting this, you know, type stuff, and yet has a certain cartoony feel too, especially feeling light but almost horror-ish, and you know, in some of those parts I think of Hell, you know, and things. So
how much money he made off that?
Who?
Sam Keith, because he did like, the, I mean, how many times those issues have been reprinted?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Well, did they have that back? I mean, were they paying royalties at that point?
I don't know. Does he get residuals or something?
Probably not at that time. Who knows?
Well, 12 times.
Yeah, at least. But overall, I mean, it's good. It's an introduction to things. I may still keep on going. It's just the fact that as I was reading through this, I was realizing, yeah, there may have been a reason I only read it once, you know, type things, because it's... It is very dense, you know, and some of that type stuff.
Well, I borrowed yours and read them, and it's good. It's just, Sandman always gets built up to be this such an amazing thing. When I read it, I'm like, well, it's good, but it may not just be my thing as much. You know what I mean? Like, it's like, it's well done, and I appreciate it, and I think it's, you know, an amazing comic, but it's not like I don't get enough enjoyment out of it to reread it a bunch of times. It's just not my style, you know. I think it's just because Neil Gaiman, he's a good writer. He's just not necessarily my favorite writer.
Yeah.
Like, I read American Gods, and it was the same kind of thing. It's like, yeah, I mean, it's good. It's well written. I enjoyed it, but it's not like, didn't like blow me away or made me want to like read it
again. Right. It makes you wonder. I thought it was solid. There you go. I mean, American Gods was solid. I mean, it kept my overall attention, you know, and things of that nature. But, you know, it may not be, my favorite of type stuff, you know, and things. Yeah. My problem is I think I remember with you, too, there's certain ones of those 10 that are better, way better than others, you know?
Yeah.
And I think that's the thing.
It meanders a little bit.
As you're reading through this, you hit those certain ones that you're just like, oh, my God, this is so much better than anything else.
Yeah.
But it's... You know, kind of finding that little diamond in the rough here and there, you know, and then you hit that and you're like, wow, that was amazing. I'm going to keep reading some more, you know, type things and maybe try to get that feel again. And then 10, 12 issues later, boom, there's another one, you know, or something like that. Even though as a whole, I don't know if it's the best thing ever, though.
There's a lot of stuff you have to kind of drudge through.
Yeah, I would agree on some cases like that. Which even like this one, you know, I mean, there's certain ones in here that I don't think are as good as others. I mean, even the guy that he gets his diamond, you know, from. Now, there's that issue of the diner, which is, wow, that one's like creepy and has this weird tea feel. But then the very next issue, it just is like, oh, well, I got to write an issue so I know that Dream gets his damn power back. Okay, you know, and it's... I mean, it tries to be a little grandiose, but it's just a filler. It's not all that good. Right. And then you get to the next one in which he introduces death, and it's like, oh, wow. You know, I mean, it's almost heartbreaking in some of that, you know, type stuff. You know, so it definitely has its ebb and flows in this.
Yeah. I'd like to go back and read them. I mean, I invested a lot of money in the story.
There you go.
Nice to read it again.
So now in quarantine, I'm kind of going back and going, huh, maybe that's something that I can read.
All right, I'll do this, and then you can do that, because this is going to be really quick, because I really don't remember a whole lot about it. All right, so I really committed to buying all of these, but the big draw on this one was Kelly Jones' artwork. I love Kelly Jones, so Kelly Jones does, like, creepy stuff pretty good.
What else does he do?
Creepy stuff. What's Batman?
He did Batman Forever, and then he did that book, what was that? The
like a Viking
The Crusades. Book?
Yeah. Crusades.
Which was good. I mean, but yeah, you'd probably just know him from Batman.
Batman.
Well, I mean, you probably don't know him at all, but if anything, you'd probably know him from Batman is probably what he's done the most of, or is most famous for. But, okay, so anyway, there's this girl. Her name is Daphne Byrne.
Well, that's what the book's called.
Yeah.
Nice.
She's like a teenager-ish, I think. Her dad has passed away. They have some money, her mom, because I think it's like probably in the 1800s, because it's kind of Victorian age type stuff is what it looks like. But anyway, her dad passes away. They have a little bit of money, but it seems like it's running out.
Money does that.
Yeah. And the mom has started going to see this a psychic, because they told her all the right things, and she believes that she's speaking to her dead husband or whatever. And then the daughter starts, well, she's in a dream, and this guy comes to her and says, you know, I can take you to your father,
bring
your
dad back.
Yeah, I can bring I can take you to him. I can let you see him, whatever, blah, blah, blah. And then, so in the dream, he says she has to sacrifice this pig. And then, so she does. And then when she wakes up, she has blood all over her hands. Like when she wakes up. And then the next issue, it's kind of that dude is like following her around, but you don't know if he's like real or not, just trying to get her, hey, come over here. So I don't really, it's only two issues. That's about the story. It's just her trying to get back to her dad, and there's this guy that can show up in her dreams and show up in real life, and I don't know. That's all I know. I don't.
You really went all in on these Hill comics, didn't you? That's interesting. You're not even a big horror guy. Why don't you just pick a couple? I mean, this Kelly Jones one makes sense.
Yeah, the Kelly Jones one did.
Plunge makes sense.
It seemed like an interesting idea, and I thought I would give the line a try. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
So, I mean, that's really kind of what I did, but yeah. But yeah, I would have bought this. This would have been one I would have bought just because of the Kelly Jones.
I hear
you. And I'm a big fan of his art.
I bought the first deluxe edition of Fables like a while back, but never read it.
That's an eighth printing.
Thank you.
That's a fourth printing.
And then I got book two, and so I figured, oh, I'll start reading these.
Are they deluxe editions?
Because I never finished Fables. I mean, I read quite a few of Scott's trades over the years.
How many of them are there? Because there was 150 issues, but...
There's 15 of these.
Is there 15 of those? Because I was thinking there was... Oh, how many trades were there? 20?
I think there's like 20 trades.
And the last issue was like a whole trade.
Yeah, yes, it was. Like a whole
trade. Yeah. Because the first one is 1 to 10, but the second one is only like 11 to 18.
But they threw in the last castle.
Right.
Because he did a lot of like side
stuff. He did a lot of side stuff.
One shots and specials. Yes.
But where are you going to catch up? Because you're already behind.
I don't know. I'm just telling you there's...
No, I understand, but that's what I'm just...
What do you mean by you're already behind?
Because if you're doing 15 trades, 10 issues a trade, you're already behind on the second one because you're only up to 18.
Yeah.
They must get thicker.
They may.
They may. But yeah, I believe there's 15. No, I think they're all the same price.
Are they?
But
you just got ripped up. So ripped off in that second one, huh?
So.
No, you're getting
the
same amount of stuff.
Well, when I was looking at them, I was like, it is odd how they keep collecting less. You know, like, why are... Because most of these hardcovers are, like, 12 issues. And it's like, first one's 10, okay. And the second one's, like, only, like, 8 plus a special. I'm like...
Yeah.
But, whatever. Anyway. So, Fables. First arc is kind of a murder mystery type thing. I've heard people say that it's not the strongest thing and that it doesn't really get good to the second arc, but I enjoyed the first arc.
I thought
it was
good.
I thought it was pretty well done.
It's introducing the pieces and things of that.
What I did notice is this Lan Medina does art in the first one, then Mark Buckingham takes over in the second arc. I love Mark Buckingham's art a lot more than I like Lan Medina's art.
Yeah.
He just has a much smoother, cooler
style.
He stays
on it for the whole run.
And I think he ends up being the main guy with a bunch of fill-ins kind of people around him.
With some little special guests.
Yeah, I don't think he does the whole thing, but he definitely does a good chunk of it. And he does stay on. I think Lan Medina drops off. He did some stuff in the second book. But the second one is pretty cool. It's like, so people don't know what Fables is. Basically, it's all the fables, like, you know, Snow White and Rose Red and Pinocchio and all those kind of fancy fairy tale stories. Well, they all lived in, like, the Fable Land. Well, they all got, a bunch of them got driven out of Fable Land by the adversary. And they basically escaped through a portal and they came to our world. And so they're trying to assimilate to, like, our society or whatever. Or trying to live in our world, but... You know, they have all sorts of spells, and they're trying to, like, you know...
Really show themselves.
And so anybody who can't pass as, like, a human, you know, like the talking pigs from the Big Bad Wolf or whatever, you know, they have to go live in a place called the Farm. And there's, like, this whole different town called the Farm where they put all those people because they can't... Because I guess magic costs money, and it's expensive, and it takes a lot of energy to, like, make people look human. And so they don't have enough energy with them, and so... Anybody who can't afford, like, a glamour and, you know, they can't, the Fable Town can't do it, so they have to live on the farm. So the second arc is about how the people on the farm are mad because they don't get to ever leave the farm. There's, like, a revolution, and so they have to put down, like, a revolution and deal with that. There's, like, some traitors and stuff. And so that's, like, the second arc. And then the third arc is Storybook Love, and that's the main one of the book two. And so basically it's Snow White and Bigby. He's the big bad wolf, but he looks human or whatever. Well, Snow White's kind of like the administrator of the town. She's like kind of right under the mayor. She kind of does all the day-to-day stuff. And then Bigby is like...
She runs the town.
Yeah, she really runs it. And then Bigby, he's like the town sheriff. So they kind of work together. Well, I guess Bigby's kind of had a thing for her for a while, but she does not reciprocate. Well, they get bewitched and sent off into the
years.
So they get they get bewitched and sent off because there's like a plot in Fable Town to like kind of take it over. And so they get bewitched and sent off like camping off, and then someone's going to go assassinate them. Well, it doesn't work, and then they wake up like 3 days later in like a tent, and they don't know what's happened or whatever, you know. So the implication is maybe they had relations, they don't know, or maybe they were just out here camping, but they don't remember. So anyway, they foil the assassination attempt, they get back to Fable Town, save the day, blah, 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 all that good stuff. The kicker at the end, though, is turns out Snow White is pregnant. And she's like, what happened in those 3 days? He's like, dude, I was bewitched just like you. Anyway, so that's the kicker. And then the end of the book, too, they collect the last castle, which is the story of the very last stronghold in Fable world, where they like everybody got out who could get out right before they lost like their last foothold in this.
Is that with Boy
in
Blue?
Fable world. Yeah, Boy Blue's in it. It's a pretty cool story. It has a cool little twist and it's interesting. And yeah, I actually remember a lot of
Fables for reading all of them and how long it's been. I actually remember a lot of it. I guess it just made an impression on me.
Yeah, it's a good book. Yeah. It's like an excellent book, and I've enjoyed it. Yeah. Like I said, I got through quite a few that Scott gave me, and I just kind of, I knew I was going to go back and read it sometime, so I just kind of waited. The only bad thing is like, okay, so book three I was going to get, and then book four was out of print. And I'm like, so I look on Amazon, somebody wants like $800 for it or something. I'm like, I'm not paying $800 for a hardcover of book four of Fables.
Wow.
And so I'm like, well, these are really good sellers for DC. Like Fables is like a moneymaker for them. Like after Sandman, this was probably their biggest hit series or whatever. You know, it went 150 issues,
it was a good chunk,
sold a lot of trades. They put out deluxe editions. I mean, they've got to keep it in print, right? And like you said, the first one's eighth printing, the second one is fourth printing. Surely they're going to come back in print. So I wasn't sure. So I found Bill Willingham on Twitter. I guess he has a YouTube channel now too. And I just messaged him on Twitter. I say, hey, dude, I noticed like Fables like book four and five are out of print. You know when they're going to get back in print? He's like, well, I did, but now I'm not sure because of all the stuff going on, you know. Yeah, but I don't know for sure, but it kind of made me think, yeah, they will eventually be put back in print. The idea is to keep these deluxe editions in print.
Right.
It sounds
weird, though, that you would, why would he have any idea? Like, it's out of his hands. DC?
It's out of his hands, but he's still, like, I think he owns a stake in it. Like, I mean, I think it's partially creator owned. Like, he has a...
Well, yeah, but...
And so he gets paid, and so he wants the stuff to stay in print, so he keeps getting money.
Right, but...
And maybe he has a contract with DC, says they have to keep stuff in print. I don't know how those contracts work. I mean, I'm sure it says, like, yeah, I mean, you have to keep my books in print. If you don't, then I'm going to go publish them myself.
Yeah, gotcha.
That's
what
I'm
thinking, too.
That's how they got the Watchmen rights for 40 years.
You could just pull the Preacher like I did when I couldn't get number 5 in the hardcover. I just bought the softcover version.
Yeah, I mean, if I get desperate, I could just borrow the stock.
I was going to say, you just talk to me. I mean, I've got all the trades.
But, I mean, the idea is to get all the hardcovers and read them all kind of in a certain amount of time.
Yeah, no, I understand. And that's why I went with the soft cover with the Preacher, because the TV show was out. It was popular. It was out of print. Totally. I didn't want to pay $500 for bringing
but Fables is pretty solid. You know, he does all these like little side stories throughout, you know, and that's cool, but sometimes I wish he'd just get... I remember reading the trades, I wish he'd just kind of get to the main story, but... As I'm going through it the second time, I'm a little more patient. I'm like, it's cool. Let's just go on all your little side stories and just enjoy the journey.
I think in some cases, though, it's because he had this great buildup of this whole adversary. Yeah. You're like, who the hell is that?
When did that go?
Like 50.
Was
that like, I think
it was like somewhere
50
in the 50s.
Or 75.
Yes. I think you found out around 50.
50 who it is.
No, they didn't defeat him until around 75 or something like that is what I'm thinking.
Yeah, that's cool. So, that's a cool.
But therein lies the rub a little bit because he did such a good job of building this up and setting this all up and everything else. The reveal is really good, but by the time the war actually happens and they defeat him, he built this up so much and you were really bought in. I mean, his reveal is cool, how what happens with it is cool, everything else after that happens, it's kind of like, well, what the hell are you doing now? Well, I'm going to throw in this little bad guy. Well, yeah, he's kind of an ass, but he's not the adversary, you know. You know, this type of stuff that it never seemed like he could really top off of that. You know, he still pulls off, you know, another 75 issues or something, but it just never felt that there was as much of a threat as that dang
adversary. It's kind of a Walking Dead problem. Like, the governor was such a good villain, and you're like, how are they going to top that? And they did Negan, you know, so he had to do Negan to kind of top him, and then after that, he's kind of like, eh.
Well, it gets, I mean, it still gets interesting. I mean, you know, you have the whole thing with Snow White and Big Bushy and their kids.
And they do. Turns out and his father, and North Wind, you know, and stuff.
One of the other things is cool is that Cinderella, they did a spinoff of that Cinderella. Yes,
I have three of those.
I think they did one or two.
There's three trades. Six. Three small trades.
But those were really cool because Cinderella was like the James Bond. Oh, like the spy. She kicks like, ass. Those are good too. I mean, a lot of the spinoff stuff is great.
It is. Yeah.
I don't know. Yeah, it was just so good. It was so different at the time. Like, I remember, you know, that I don't even, like, I have all the issues, but I didn't start. Like, I got lucky and got, I think it was almost like Walking Dead either. I'm missing like one or two. Like I have number one and I miss number two, or I have like number two and I miss number one. Like I'm missing one of the very early issues of Fables just because I couldn't find it.
Yeah,
it was like Walking Dead because it was like insane. Like when it came out.
But now's the time to find it if you want it.
Right. It's not worth much. I'm fine. I can go back and read 150 issues and miss number two. I don't mind it.
Yeah, he got kind of hosed on the whole thing for like a television contract and whatnot, where
I think they were shipping it around,
but then ABC did, well, fine, screw you, we're gonna go do our own, you know, type thing.
Once upon a time. Yeah.
Wasn't there another series that was like Once Upon a Time?
Yeah, something that was on it was on NBC at the time, I think, as well.
Yeah, there were like two series that were kind of like mimicking Fables a little bit.
In fact, I think I met Bill Willingham at like some convention. I think The Last Castle, I think I have that one shot. I think that's autographed by him.
Wow.
If I remember right.
Cool. Yeah, I remember meeting him. He's a cool guy.
Yeah.
He's also known for doing the Elementals from Amico. That was his other big thing.
He did this one. It was only like two or three, maybe four issues. It was a book called Coventry. Yeah. It was black and white, and I had that, and I took that to get him to sign it, and he was kind of surprised, because I think he actually drew that.
Yeah. Well, he drew some elements.
He drew some elementals, too.
Well, then they had the whole spinoff with Jack of Tales and whatnot, too, or whatever.
Yeah.
He didn't really write, I don't think.
I think he got the other guy to write it.
Yeah.
The guy who did the Viking book that Lucas drew.
But, cool. And it wasn't as good, but it honestly was kind of amusing if you just had the right...
Yeah,
you had to go in. Right, that was one that you really had to go in with the right mental.
And I didn't stick with it. I think I went like 20 issues or 15. I did not finish that series.
I've got all the trades of that series too.
Yeah, I think I borrowed your trade.
Yeah, anyone wants to ever read it, but yeah, I'm definitely I bought all in on the Fables thing.
Yeah, Fables is good.
Got all those.
So it's fun to go back and read. It holds up pretty darn well.
The only thing I don't have is pretty sure I've got all the Cinderella trades, but I don't think that I've got all the Ferris trades when that came out.
The what?
Ferris.
Oh,
and he had that little offshoot.
It did have a lot of spin-offs.
Yeah.
And Stable, I think I have cash cow.
I think I have the first one of the Ferris, but I want to say that there's like three trades there too or so. But
yeah, I think I might have stuck with that one for a little while too. I don't think I finished everything except Fables. I stuck with Fables the whole way.
Yeah.
In single issues.
Well, because it was good. I mean, even when it, you know, after they defeat the adversary, it's still solid.
I think after 100, like, you go, like, 110 to, like, 120 or 130, it kind of meanders a little bit. Yeah. And then kind of picks up steam towards the end. I remember somewhere around after 100, it just kind of, like, I didn't really enjoy it as much, but I just kept buying it.
And I felt like... Yeah, you're right.
Not that it was bad. It just wasn't the oomph that everything... Because it's still... Bad Fables is still better than probably 90% of the stuff that was coming out at the time. It was just... It wasn't like you guys with the Star Wars. It just wasn't the...
Yeah. Well, he kept trying to figure out, you know, more conflict, you know, and where to do whatever type stuff. And it was still, you know, well type things. But here again, okay, so much like Star Wars or whatever type things... You get to issue 150 or whatever, they go all out, you know, on that thing. Mm-hmm. That thing is freaking, you know, like, what the hell, 50 or more damn pages.
Oh, it's more than that. It's its own trade.
It is. It's huge. It's, you know, this big old thing. And for me, I felt it was a good conclusion to everything. It was satisfying. you know, type things. Maybe not everything ended the way that I expected, but it still satisfied me much, you know, overall. Yeah. It's much like Invincible, you know, and stuff.
Yeah.
They led it to a point. They closed it very well,
yeah.
you know, type things.
I mean, it was like trade 19 or trade 20 or whatever. It was
it's like the last there. Trade. Yeah, I know. It is its own little trade there. I remember that. I've got it. I just can't remember how many damn pages.
Have you read all of this? You haven't read
no,
all
No, I haven't. That's okay. what I'm saying. I read for a while.
For Scott a little bit.
Gotcha. Yeah.
You quite know. A few. I made it like to probably 12 or 13 of the trades.
Oh, okay. 15. So you know about the adversary. And
yeah, yeah.
Who the adversary is, probably who they defeated and everything, and probably even the next guy.
The problem is that they came out so sporadically, I'm starting to lose track of it because I read so much other stuff. And so Scott would be like, you want the trade? I'm like, well, it's, I'm not going to know where I'm at because it's been like, you know, 6 months.
6 months before, it, yeah. Know,
and it just
wasn't it like
confusing?
Some, yeah, I don't know.
Okay. All right. Anything else?
Nope.
Anything else?
No.
All right. So I think we're done. Thanks for listening, everybody. We will see you in a couple weeks. Hope everybody's healthy. Bye.
Bye.
Yeah.